நமோ ரமணாய நலம் பெற வாழ்க, விமோச்சனமெய்யன் விரை மலர்த்தாள் வாழ்க.
நமோ ரமணாய நலம் பெற வாழ்க, விமோச்சனமெய்யன் விரை மலர்த்தாள் வாழ்க.
I'm sitting in front of the holy mountain of Arunachala in Tamil Nadu, South India. I've been asked to give an explanation of just why so many people consider this to be a sacred place, a holy place, and why some of them, such as Ramana Maharshi, say this is the most sacred, the holiest place in the world. So I'll rewind a little bit, and we'll start with the foundation myth of Arunachala. The traditional Hindu story of this place is that long, long ago, Brahma and Vishnu, two of the three principal Hindu gods, were having a dispute as to which one was the greater. Shiva wasn't present, but was aware of their dispute and decided to teach these two gods a lesson. So he came here and manifested himself as an infinitely long column of light, and challenged the two quarreling gods, whichever of you two can find either extremity of this column of light will be considered greater than me and greater than the other god. So Vishnu took the form of a boar and he started burrowing down into the earth. Brahma took the form of a swan and started flying up to try and find the top of this column. Vishnu went down and down and down for thousands of years. He gave up, came back, prostrated to Shiva and said, "You're greater than I am. I couldn't find the bottom of this column. I give up. You're greater than I am." Meanwhile, Brahma had been flying upwards for thousands and thousands of years and was getting understandably a bit tired, but he didn't want to give up. So he then saw a flower floating down from the top of the column. So since this is an old myth, we have talking flowers. So he asked the flower, "Where have you come from? How far is it to the top of this column?" The flower, which was actually a screwpine flower from a pandanus plant, said, "Don't waste your time trying to fly any higher. I've been falling for thousands of years. You'll never make it to the top of this column." So Brahma was feeling extremely tired, so he felt, "Well, if I get this flower on my side, we can cheat. If this flower will back up my story that I found it on the top of the column, we can both go back to Shiva. I can say I got to the top of this column, and then we can claim the prize of being considered the greatest god." So he talked this flower into telling a lie. He said, "I'll take you back to the bottom, and we'll tell this story to Shiva when we get down." So Brahma came back, got the flower to say, "Yes, yes, he picked me off the top of this column." He went to the top, and of course Shiva knew this story was completely wrong. He knew they hadn't got there, so he cursed Brahma to say, "From now on, there'll be no Brahma temples in India. Nobody will worship you. This is your curse." And to the flower he said, "You're now considered unholy. Nobody may use you as a flower for temple worship." I think in the whole of India, there are only two Brahma temples and nobody uses this flower for worship. Then both gods realized that they were humbled. They realized that Shiva was the greater god. So they prostrated to him, asked for his forgiveness, and they both accepted his superiority. Then, according to the tradition, that the column of light was far too bright, far too dazzling for anyone to see without being blinded. So the gods asked Shiva if he would re-manifest in a form that would still be Shiva himself, but which could be seen, visited, and worshipped by pilgrims who wouldn't be blinded by the light. Shiva accepted the invitation, and he condensed himself into what you now see behind me, the mountain of Arunachala. So the key thing to understand from the perspective of a Hindu who sees this mountain is that we're not talking about a mountain where Shiva lives or which is associated in some way with Shiva. This rock behind me for thousands upon thousands of South Indian Hindus is Shiva himself. This is a living rock lingam that doesn't merely represent Shiva. What you see behind me is the physical form of Shiva himself. Jnana Sambandha, who was probably the oldest Tamil saint to write about this place 1500 years ago, he called this mountain Jnana Tiral in Tamil, which means a distillation, a condensation of jnana. So that was Ramana Maharshi's favorite description of this mountain. It's Shiva condensed, solidified into a form that is pure knowledge, pure Godhead, if you like, which stands physically in a location on earth where pilgrims can approach and worship it. There are, of course, other sacred places in South India. According to the Saiva tradition, Saiva is the adjective from Shiva, there are five principal Shiva temples in South India, and each one is associated with one of the five elements. So there's an earth temple, a water temple, an air temple. This because historically of the infinite column of light, which occasionally appears in mythology as a column of fire, became the fire lingam of South India. So although you can say that it's one of five principal places in South India where pilgrims go to on pilgrimage, for many, many people who are devotees, this place is God himself in a way that no other place on earth is. The hill is regarded as a lingam in different forms. There's the mountain itself, and there's also the lingam in the principal temple on the east side of the hill, the Arunachaleshwara temple. And according to the scriptures, Shiva is equally this mountain, and he's equally the lingam in the temple at the foot of the hill on the east side. So traditionally, there's no separation between the lingam inside the main temple and the mountain itself. Both are the form of Shiva, and both are worshipped by Saivas as Shiva himself.
Namo Ramanaya Nalam Peravalga Vimochanamiyan.
This mountain has exercised a kind of magnetic attraction to spiritually mature people for as long as records have been kept on this place. The oldest verifiable visits that I know of come from saints who came here in the 500s. And when they came here, they would sing songs in praise of Arunachala, saying what a great and holy place it was. And it's quite clear from the reverent tone of their remarks that they're describing a place which already has a very rich and ancient history. They're not coming and saying this is a new place. They're coming and saying this is a place which for time immemorial has been a manifestation of Shiva, and they sing songs in praise of it. Now, Ramana Maharshi, who's probably the most famous recent devotee of the mountain, he was asked whether the power of this mountain is a result of everybody believing it's something special, or is there something inherently powerful in the mountain itself which causes people to come, independent of their beliefs? And he said, taking the fire analogy again, he said, this mountain is like fire. He said, if you put your finger in a fire, whether you believe it in or not, you're going to get your finger burned. He said, this is a mountain of spiritual fire. It attracts people, and everybody who comes close to it gets warmed and ultimately burned by this fire. Now, that there was one particular line that Bhagavan used once or twice. He said that there was a saint who lived on the east side of the hill about 400 years ago, and in one of his poems he wrote, Arunachala, you draw to yourself all those who are rich in jnana tapas. Now, I need to explain what this means. Jnana means the ultimate experience of reality, enlightenment, and tapas is the arduous, strenuous effort that you make to attain that goal. So what he is really saying is that all those people who have a strong yearning for liberation, a strong yearning for this jnana, somehow Arunachala, the power of Arunachala, gets to know about it, and it starts attracting those people to come. So historically, over the last minimum 1500 years, this power of Arunachala has attracted a lot of quite famous saints. Some have just come and sung its praises, and a significant group who have felt its attraction, who've come here, who've lived here, who've spent their whole life here, and they have confirmed what all the other great saints have said, that there's a power in this place which is not dependent on belief. There is a power in this place which is an emanation, a radiation of the divinity, and that if you can tune into that emanation, that radiation, then you yourself can become divine.
Namo Ramanaya Nalam Peravalga Vimochanameyan Viraima.
Now, people used to come to Ramanashram during Ramana's lifetime and say, oh, Bhagavan has brought me here, the power of Bhagavan has brought me here. And sometimes he would say, you're projecting all this onto me. What brought me here? It was the power of Arunachala. What has brought you here is that same power. Right now you're projecting it onto me because you read about me in a book and you've come here and you think I'm the one who's pulled you here. But actually the ultimate power, the ultimate drawing agent is Arunachala, and the power that brings all people to come and sit at its feet. Now, this is what happened in his own case, so he has, in a way, unique authority to talk about this. Ramana was born several hundred miles from here, and after a few moves in his early life, when he was a 16-year-old boy in Madurai, he had a spontaneous enlightenment experience, came to Tiruvannamalai and spent the rest of his life here. Now, why Tiruvannamalai is very interesting. He said that in one of his poems, he said, from my unthinking childhood, the immensity of Arunachala had shone in my awareness. So this phrase, unthinking childhood, what it actually means is at an age before he even had the capacity to think about Arunachala, before he could be told what it was, what it might denote, something inside him knew intuitively, instinctively, that Arunachala was God in some way. He said, I didn't have to be told that. That was my instinctive knowledge from before I could even think coherently. That's been with me for my whole life. So as a child in kind of the cultural background he was in, he said my projection of that inner feeling was that Arunachala must represent some heaven, some godly realm. It wasn't a place that you could visit on earth. For him, he just had an image of it as a great heavenly realm, the holiest place imaginable. So imagine his shock when, as an early teenager, one of his relatives arrived and somebody said, where have you come from? And he said, Tiruvannamalai, Arunachala. And Ramana was saying, what? You mean that's a real place, a place you can actually visit? And his relative said, yes, it's just a few hundred miles north. Lots of people go there. So his first reaction to that was a little bit of deflation. He'd been holding out Arunachala as being this unreachable, ethereal, heavenly world, equating it with God himself. So there was a kind of minor deflation. But then I think the old feelings, the old conviction that this was in some way not a distant heavenly realm, but God himself manifesting on earth, reasserted itself. And when, after his enlightenment experience in Madurai, he felt a compulsion to leave home, the only possible destination for him was Arunachala. At that point, he regarded Arunachala as his father. I think later he articulated it as his guru, but the note he left to his family when he gave up life in Madurai and came here, he said, in search of my father. He knew that he was coming to see his spiritual father and that he wasn't coming home. He just dropped everything, had a very adventurous trip here and arrived here as a 16-year-old in 1896, knowing well in advance that he was going to see his father, unite with his father, be with his father, and just present himself at his father's feet in a way, and just let life take its course. So he arrived here on September 1st, 1896, and the first thing that happened was he walked through an empty temple. All the doors just seemed to open in front of him. He went to the principal lingam at the back of the temple. Nobody was there, the priests were not there. So he went over the bar that no one is supposed to go to at the end, and he physically hugged the lingam in the main shrine. Now that's a no-no, no one's allowed to do that. So he kept that secret for a long time. But he said that from the moment he had his experience in Madurai until the moment he hugged that lingam in the temple, there was a kind of burning sensation in his body. And he said, the moment I hugged that lingam, it's as if that burning energy was grounded in some way. It dissipated and it never appeared again. So if you remember, I said that the lingam is regarded as a co-manifestation of Shiva. The mountain itself is the big lingam, and the Arunachalaswara lingam in the temple is the smaller version. He was physically enacting a kind of union with his own guru, with his own god. By stepping over that bar and by hugging the lingam, he was letting his body catch up with the union that had already taken place in Madurai. He brought his body to the physical form of his guru, his god. He embraced that physical form. That burning sensation which had been inside him for weeks disappeared. He left the inner shrine of the temple, and so far as I'm aware, he never went back in there again. His business with that particular lingam was finished. He'd come to Tiruvannamalai, he'd united with his god, and from that moment on, he just let destiny take its course.
Namo Ramanayanalam Peravalu Vimochanamayan Virai.
I think most people in India will know Tiruvannamalai for possibly Ramana Maharshi, but more likely because of its famous Deepam festival. Deepam means light, and it's a celebration of the traditional Brahma-Vishnu story that I told you about, where Shiva manifests as a column of light and later condenses himself into a form that's capable of being worshipped by pilgrims. So once a year, in around the full moon between mid-November and mid-December, there's a Tamil month called Kartikai. Somewhere in that 30-day span, this festival will fall. And it's a biggie. I would say, I don't know who counts or how accurate the counting is, but I would say a couple of million people will be here on the final day that a light is lit on top of the mountain. It's lit about sunset on the final evening of the last day of the festival, and then it's relit every day for the succeeding 10 days. Most people who come here will walk around the foot of Arunachala in the morning of that day, and this is an extraordinarily big mob scene. It's quite overwhelming to watch. It's a river of people that is so packed and moving at such a speed that there's no way that you can cross the road. There's never a gap. It's shoulder to shoulder. It's just a slow walking speed, 15, 20 abreast people marching their way around the hill. They get back at various times, midday, afternoon. Then they all sit around and wait for the lighting of the hill, lighting of the flame on top of the hill. And then that's it. Seeing the lighting is the key point for most people. After that, they go home. But this whole festival is really a celebration of the status of the mountain as a manifestation of Shiva, and how to enable devotees to have a visible form to worship Shiva, because the original bright firelight form was too dazzling for people to see.
Namo Ramanayanalam Peravalu Vimochanamayan.
Ramana Maharshi came here as a 16-year-old in 1896, and despite many attempts to take him away different parts of India, he could never be persuaded to go more than 1 mile away from the foot of the hill. He spent his entire adult life here and passed away here at 70 years of age, having never been out of sight of the hill for 54 years. What was the attraction? I think if you're in this state, if you're in this state of jnana, then there's something about this hill which is no longer a lump of rock. You see it, you feel it, you know it to be jnana, the formless reality that the Hindus called jnana. This is truth, this is reality, this is what's real. Somebody wrote a letter to the ashram saying, please take a rock from the holiest, most sacred part of the hill and post it to me. I want a rock from the holiest part of the hill. And Bhagavan laughed and said, every single pebble on this hill is holy. There's no more sacred place. There's no more powerful place. You can take the rock from anywhere you like. It's all exactly the same. There's something about this hill which I think he saw, he knew to be light, knowledge, wisdom. These are all the synonyms for the self. That power emanating from this physical form of light, physical form of knowledge, it brought him here, it kept him here, and there was no competing form that could ever persuade him to move away from it. This was his guru, this was his god. This was his destiny. He was going to sit here and spend the rest of his life here. I could just cite one or two people. I've done some research on a famous saint who originally came from Karnataka called Guhai Namashivaya. He came here in the 16th century. He had a guru in Karnataka who said he could come here after he had had a dream saying he should come. This man came. And in a way, his life mirrors Ramana Maharshi's own life, in that he took the mountain to be his guru. He relied on the grace and power of the mountain. And ultimately, through its power, he realized the self, and then spent every day of the rest of his life writing poems about the mountain, in which he praised the mountain, thanked the mountain, spoke of the mountain as the power which had brought about his own liberation. So Ramana, in a sense, is not unique in that he's just the latest of a long list of great mature saints who've been drawn to this place by the power of this place and who have somehow been pulled to this mountain by its power, and the mountain chose not to release them, so they spent the rest of their life here.
Namo Ramanaya Nalam Peravalga Vimochanameyan
Virayam. I came to Tiruvannamalai, to Arunachala, in the 1970s, thinking I was coming here because of Ramana, for Ramana. And I think, as Ramana says, you start off with this idea, and that ultimately you realize it's the power of this mountain that brought you here and kept you here. Now, I'm not saying I'm anything special. I'm just one of innumerable, countless people who felt the pull, who've come here, who've felt the magnetism, the power of this place, being pulled to it as an iron filing is pulled to a magnet, who don't have any competing force to push them away, and who've ended up spending their whole life here. It kept me here, and because I wasn't in the same mature, enlightened state as these other people, I fought the power for a little bit. I tried to run away a few times. Every time I tried to do something somewhere else, whatever I tried to do didn't work very well. Unless I was going off to sit with some teacher, that was fine. But every time I made an escape bid, everything went disastrously wrong. And every time I came back here, everything went very well. And finally I realized, okay, don't kick against your destiny here. You're destined to be here to do the things that you're doing. And if you try and run away, it's not going to work. Now, I remember I was walking around the hill. This is back in the 1970s. And I came here young with not much money. I fell in love with the place immediately. But there was always this feeling inside me, I'm on a visit. I don't have much money. Sooner or later, I'll have to buy a ticket and go home. And this was not a conscious decision on my part. I was just walking around the hill one morning, and quite literally, I stopped in my tracks. I was walking forward, and you know, the next step didn't happen. And I just felt myself rotating 90 degrees towards the hill. And something in me, in that moment, knew that some power had brought me to Arunachala, some power had made me stay, and it wasn't my decision. And when that power was finished with me, it would spit me out and I'd have to leave, whether I had means to support myself or not. But that power had delivered me to Tiruvannamalai to be in Tiruvannamalai for a reason. And from that moment on, I never worried. I never worried about how long I was going to stay, how I was going to support myself, what was going to go on. Up till that moment, I was always checking my wallet to see how much was left. And in that moment, there was a feeling of total letting go, total relaxation. It was a kind of epiphany, a knowledge that I was home, that home wasn't somewhere else I had to go back to. Home was this mountain in this place, doing what I loved the most. And after that, all the circumstances of my life, they arranged themselves. I've been here 35 years since that moment walking on the hill. I'm still here, I'm still doing what I love the most, and have no plans to be anywhere else.
Namo Ramanaya Nalam Peravalga Vimochanameyan Viraimalattalvalga
Namo Ramanaya Nalam Peravalga Vimochanameyan Viraimalattalvalga Namo Ramanaya Nalam Peravalga Vimochanameyan Viraimalattalvalga Adimudikkundaya Anadithodarvin Viramudiyamai Marandu Vittudalkundaya